Good evening. So actually, I came back last night. I came back from the Boston MIT to give my talk about Rodney Brooks' The Redefining Workshop. Anyhow, I prepared 81 slides. Therefore, I suppose maybe 30 seconds I have to switch the slide. Anyhow, as Takashi introduced, I'm a professor of Osaka University, and I'm not a cognitive science. I'm not a psychologist. I'm just a robotics researcher. But my desire is to make robots to speak something. Okay. Also, I'm the research director of the JST ELAT project, and we recently renewed our page, so please visit geat.jp. You can enjoy the many video clips and so on. And also, I'm one of the founders of the RoboCup Federations. So first of all, I'd like to show you some video clips from the RoboCup. I suppose maybe, have you ever seen the RoboCup before? Please raise your hand. Okay, there are many. So this indicates that, you know, I believe, unfortunately, the Sony already retired the robot business, therefore we cannot see anymore, but it's very, very interesting. So in this case, the hardware fixed. So therefore, many teams you know, participate by using their programs, so the competition of the programs. It has many degrees for them, but the working style is already converged because we exchange the work and information of the strategy. And then one team found that this is the best working or the running of this robot from Uganda. It's a kind of, it has many degrees for them. And also, we introduced the human leg since 2002. And this is 2004. And still not the game, but just PK. So Team Osaka, the head coach is Professor Hiroshi Ishiguro. Okay. So it has a omnidirectional vision camera on top, and then stop, and this goalie right there. Actually, this time it was allowed, but now it was not allowed. Okay. Anyway, so they set the direction, and then they set to kick. And it's changed. Very cute. And then too late. And 2007, we had the first match between the robot team and human team, because the final goal of the RoboCup is to be the team of the 11 humans that get a win against the human World Cup champion team by 2050. So only 32 years left. So anyhow, this time the robot team is the champion team of the middle side league, and then the human team consists of the RoboCup trophy, because no play happened. So anyhow, this time the robot did not have any arms, therefore the free kick. But everything automatically decided by the robot team. That means the computer control. So one player comes in and then make a free kick. Okay, this time we painted the ball in the color in red, because the image processing captured the image of the ball position, and also was, the ball is... this is followed by the robot team. Because this time, the robot team had not prepared for the match with the human teams, just exhibition. Therefore, the human teams just are supposed to be the obstacle. So this guy, the Peter Stone, the U.S. trustee, and he's very good at playing the soccer. Okay. So I'd like to show it a bit more. Okay, so they make a shoot. Okay, so the score was 2-0. The robot team lost. But anyhow, it's a very, very interesting game. So I'd like to share a little bit more, because there was a very exciting situation that the goalie of the robot team make a good saving. Okay, so anyhow, we start from the kickoff of the robot team. Okay, so in the robot team, top has the omnidirectional vision system to point it out to the upwards, and then there was a palm mirror, and then captured the whole image. Okay, so the robot team tried to get the ball and also interrupt the pass and so on. And then, okay, so the back pass, and then, okay, at this time, the goalie make a good save. Okay, so this is 2007. So the color is the board cover is painted in red, and also the field side is this one. But last year, this is the final of the middle side wave. You can see the very huge field, and also the board is not painted red or red anymore. So all the goal is not our goal. So that kind of challenge is a visual reconstruction. Okay, so this is fine again, and I suppose maybe the blue is team from Europe, and the red is from China. So the blue team make a chance, and then see. Yeah, this is a very nice game. So this year we have the RoboCup 2012 in Mexico City this June. So please, if you have time, please be there. So this is the introduction. So today I'd like to talk about the four or five topics. So my desire is, you know, like to make the robot much more intelligent. But what is the intelligence? Well, how? Why the human can't be the intelligent? Therefore, that's a big question. So therefore, we focus on the development of the human development by using to study about the human development by using the robots. Okay, so how do humans and the humanity develop? So what's the human development? Okay, so I was born 1953, and this is the elementary school, junior high school, and the high school students. And when I was an undergraduate student, I got married. And then I was in the University of Maryland in the US 1 year, and this is the first RoboCup, and I enjoyed karaoke in Shanghai. So this is a typical human development. Okay. Anyhow, so this comes from the textbook of the neuroscience. So you can see there how the early brain development. So every 2 days, 18 days from conception, 18 days, 20 days, 22, 24, every 2 days, the embryo changing and form some structure of the brain, like this one. So in these days, maybe the gene coding is dominant to make some structure of the brain. After 24 or 25 weeks, so the almost same structure, maybe the brain, almost same structure as adults. So the features obtain, but the connection not complete. So about the behavior and the sensations, what's going on in the womb? So this axis indicates how many weeks after the conception, and the vertical axis indicates what kind of behavior. For example, the sucking and swallow already happened around the 12 or 13 weeks. On the other hand, about the sensation, so the first sensation is the touch, around 10 weeks or something, and then the auditory vision started around before 20 weeks. So currently, we can see the same real movement of the features. For example, in the 26 weeks, you can see that features catch his or her own face so often. Okay, and also this shows the 36 weeks, just before the birth. So the or the features open the eyes or open the mouth and so on. Okay, so many people suppose that so the kind of learning may happen after the birth, but probably before the birth something happened already. And after the birth, there are different kinds of behaviors the newborn baby obtain. For example, at 5th month, the hand wriggle, just look at the hand, and. This kind of behavior is supposed to be the kind of the line of the board and the inverse model of the hand. Okay. So the number indicates the month, age, and the blue indicates the infant behavior, and the black indicates some kind of a learning target from viewpoint of the robotics. So at the 6th month, fingers as a face, that is the integration of the visual tactile sensation of the face. And at the 7th month, drop the object and observe the result. This is very, very important, the causality and permanency of the object. And also, at 8th month, the hit the object, or drop the brain and imitate the movement, the glass fence, and so on. So just 1 year, the newborn baby obtained so different kind of behaviors. So we are sure, we, the robotics researcher, cannot build such a robot just 1 year. Therefore, many people suppose that, okay, so from the being, something happened. So the big argument, nature versus nature. This guy is not Ridley, and he mentioned that versus is wrong. So no longer is it nature versus nature, but nature versus nature. So nowadays, nature side and nature side closely related in the different levels, and this makes our humans. Okay. So the point is that from the viewpoint of the design theory, to what extent we embed something, and to what extent we can expect some learning from the environment. So we designed this robot. Have you ever seen this one? CB Square? Please raise your hand. Okay, thanks. So this robot is our first introduction of the baby robots. Actually, this is 1.3 meters and 33 kilograms. That's not the baby, but the proportion is a very huge head. Therefore, we suppose that half a year. It has a 52 degrees of freedom, or a cylinder type, and the whole body covered the skin. Silicon skin. Underneath, we put on the 200 tactile sensors, and also it has visions, and also the auditory, and right. So we embed some kind of reflexive behavior. For example, react to the sound, react to the lighting direction, lighting, and also we embed some preference with the lighting direction. So this guy sees here, just look for the lighting direction. And then also he tried to turn out and seek for the light. Okay. So we have shown this video clip to the medical doctors, and who mentioned that this type of behavior is not normal kids, but maybe it's autistic children. Because autistic children, the normal kids turn by one leg by one leg, but I have no idea why this situation happened. Also, my colleague didn't know it. Anyhow, so why such a baby robot? Because we like to understand how the humans can be intelligent through the process of the building such robots that develop like humans. So why not such other approaches, such as brain science or psychology? Because it is not sufficient for only one discipline to attack this mystery, but interdisciplinary approach seems promising. So the brain science sometimes tends to be so microscopic. For example, this is a figure like this one. So after each part of the brain research work like ants on reactive brain. Okay. Even this was printed by in 1987. And nowadays we can observe the active brain something. But still it's very difficult to grasp what can do that unrelated the details of the thinking organs. On the other hand, also the psychology is mainly the kind of microscopic viewpoint based on the observations. So, the basic idea of the human science, we like to make design the robot like humans, but to do that, we have to know what humans are. So there is another pathway that some natural science or some literature science. Okay, this guy is that's why he's here. Okay, he invited me here. Okay, so this is a basic idea. So what the cognitive-driven robotics? So the cognitive-driven robotics aims at understanding human cognitive development process by synthetic or constructive approaches. This core idea is physical environment and social interaction that enables information structuring through the interaction with the environment, including other agents. So from now on, I'll show some examples of the environment and social interaction together. And the final symbolic goal of the cognitive development robotics is language acquisitions. So, as I explained, the robotics, the cognitive plans, the neuroscience together, and the mutual feedback. Okay. So the robots are generally reliable agents as controllable reproducible ones for the psychological and social experiment. So we like to study about the interaction between the caregiver and the infants. But sometimes infants is very difficult to deal with. Therefore, we let exchange replace the real infant to the robot by controlling the psychological center. Therefore, in that case, the robots are very reliable agent. Or also the computer model to verify the hypothesis. So we like to seek for some principle of the development, the model, the computer model, and then embed into the robot and watch what kind of interaction may happen with the humans and so on. Of course, in your future, the robots are social agent. And then we set up my project. Okay, so the Professor Hiroshi Ichiguro, he's a very famous guy of the Android, and his group is mainly social interaction, the development of social interaction. And Yasuko Niyoshi, University of Tokyo, his group is focusing on the future simulation and cognitive development. And also Professor Komusoda of Osaka University, his group is focusing on the generation of the dynamic movement, and especially the clawing and walking. And this guy, Professor Toshio Inoue at Kyoto University, local people here, he has a different color, means a different guy, means that these three guys are the robotics researchers, and myself, four. And this guy is cognitive neuroscientist. So based on the imaging studies or some joint research with medical doctors who cares autistic children and Williams syndrome, because both are two extremes of the, the disorder of the language. So we designed the different kinds of robots, the many robots. So often I was asked that, okay, can robot learn that physically? Of course, it is very, very difficult. So some researchers study about the web type of robotics, but it's still very difficult to see how the robots physically grown up or something. Therefore, we decided to design different kinds of the robots with different kinds of ages, and depending on the different research topic. So actually, this shows some different pathway, and depending on the age of the man, so we focus on some different the research issues. For example, at 10 months, or actually is our robot is 7 months, the crawling, or the 30 months, the walking, or sometimes the physical interaction, and so on. And before the birth, maybe some kind of previous simulation here. Okay. So this is Professor Yasuo Kunishi's blog for the features and the neural simulations. So they invented the fetus in the computer. Okay, but supposing that it has 200 muscles and muscle spindles, and also were some neural systems, alpha neurons, gamma neurons, and so on. And the very small brain consists of the motor area and sensor motor area, and so on. So through the interaction, each muscle has kind of the oscillation of the oscillator. So each muscle interacts with other muscles, but through the muscle skeletal system, a neural system, and also the environment in food. So this indicates some difference between the two features. One, it has a very, very uniform sensor distribution of the capillary sensors. That is different from us. The other one is non-uniform. For example, lip and fingertips has very, very high density of the capillary sensation. On the other hand, your back has very coarse. So the non-uniform distribution of the capillary sensations. So from these videos, it seems difficult to discriminate two behaviors, but statistically, the two babies, two fetuses, show the different behaviors. And consequently, we found that the fetuses with the non-human distribution of the tactile sensors may learn some older behavior or something. Or we have the different kinds. So today I have not so much time, so therefore I skip the details of the technical issues. But the top left indicates some kind of the widening gap behavior. In this case, the CV sphere cannot stand by itself. Therefore, he needs some kind of assistance. So in this case, we analyze the human behavior, how human behaves. My case, first time I failed, and second time I succeeded. Or someone succeeded from the beginning. So we had the princess from Taiwan. She tried five times. She failed five times. So it depends on the individual. So we analyzed some of the behavior of each individual. Or the top right, so this is our robot, the thinking. So what do you think? What's going on? Some communication? Or something? No answer? Okay, so some. You may suppose that some communication may happen, but it's actually random. One thing is just randomly, one robot copies other robots. Okay? So now we are using these robots to, we brought this robot to the hospital or the children, and then observe how these children, observe these robots, or sometimes control these robots. We didn't have any results yet, but in the future we'd like to utilize some data to care for these boys. Well, this indicates some kind of running flow. It has application masses, and we separate some characters to run. At the beginning, it's just almost no movement, but after 2.5 hours, so this device can move by using this and flowing. Or this indicates kind of some empty container for the details as it's best. This is very, very famous robot for the robot. And we put it in a white document. It has tactile sensors and so on. So, summary in the world. In a project, we started with the simulations and also the sensory motor mapping and the higher order cognitions and some social behavior such as joint attentions, bowel imitations, and so on, so on, so on. And also, this indicates more details about research topics. We have done totally 6.5 years, we have done many research results. So among them, so I indicated some study related to the language. Okay, one is the bowel imitations. Another one is the multimodal joint attentions for the class facilitated one. That is the integration of the joint attention and lexical addition. The third one is a neural network for the language comprehension and synthetic processing. Okay. So we picked the three different studies in relation to the language development. So I briefly catch the first two, and then I will give the details about the three. Okay, because of course all are related to our project, but the number two and number three, especially number three, is related to the physical embodiment and social interactions. Okay, the first one is based on the imaging studies, Professor Toshio Inui's group. So they found that some kind of brain lesions, and they made some model of the language acquisition and the comprehension model. So they found that, okay, the mainly consists of Broca area and the Brodmann area 47 and the basal ganglia. They modeled to acquire the synthetic populations and symbol grounding. And they found that, based on the imaging studies, they found that these ones. And found the consist this kind of the models. Okay. This is the imaging study. The next one is kind of some engineering solutions. So we proposed some kind of the mutual exclusive selection principle for the learning the multimodal mapping. In this case, the vision and auditory. So the situation is like this one. So where the human teacher teaches the robot by using the joint attention and utterance of the lexicons. So the situation is like this one. I'm not sure the hey. No sounds. Okay. So the caregiver teach or the first gaze to the object, attended the object, and then utter the level of the object. The robot at the beginning he has no idea about the combination of the left or right center of the light or the gaze direction and also the name of the level of something. So through the interactions, so the robot gradually learn how to gaze with to make a joint attention with the caregiver and also memorize the something the word level of something. So the, as a result, we improve the success rate of the joint attention. So this is a normal behavior learning, the just case behavior learning, and also the mutual exclusion is this one, and also the match. Match means using the utterance with the word and so on. So the success rate is increasing by using the proper model. And also about the how many words, the number of the acquisition levels. So we're using the mutual match model joint attention and advance or something. And then the number of words is increased by using this one. Okay. So this is just almost 24 minutes past. Okay. So that's today's future issues. How do robots, the vocalists, vocalize bowels like infants. So, as I mentioned, the final goal, well, one of the final goal of the cognitive development robotics is to acquire the language. But based on the physical embodiment, we like to start the vocalization. Because, of course, in our American Sign Language, ASL is, of course, the language, but to start thinking about the vocal, to think about the language acquisitions, vocalization is not easy, but it seems better way to start something. So the bioimitation between the agent with the different artificial parameters by the particular teaching, that's our research study. So the agent seems to acquire the findings without any extreme knowledge about the relationship between the sensory motor system and phonemes, that is articulation and listening. Okay, they do not seem to know this kind of relationship. They also there is the capability to reproduce the other sound as they are because in the different hardware. But somehow they can obtain the phonemes with the parents. How can the robot do that? So that this indicates that the human vocalization system. I just copied from the Tilly's book of the language, a cooperation of the language of the brain. So it has a very complicated system, and now the midbrain is working to control the sub-vocalizations. And also from the point of the evolution process, our humans have much more projection from the cortex, so to control the sub-vocalizations. Okay. So to inspire the David's works, we just design very simple vocal robot, not so facilitating the humans or android, just a very simple silicon chip. So the question is, the purpose is to build a robot that acquires the powers of the human caregivers. The design issue is what kind of the mechanism should be embedded from the beginning, and what should be the behavior of the caregiver. Okay? So look at the real situations. Okay. So infant speech rate cooing tend to make its mother or the maternal imitation of the infant's cooing increase the vocalization rate of the 3-month infant. So the mutual imitation is a very good trigger for the infant to make some practice with the utterance. Because you know the mother is very happy if the baby imitates the mother's voice. Now also the baby is also happy if their mother imitates his or her voice. Therefore we conjecture that so it reinforces infant speech like cooing, and it helps to find the correspondence between the cooing and phonemes. So we designed the robots, and we put on the artificial vocal cord, and change the silicon shape, and then activate some sound. And also, it has a microphone, and as a sound feature, we extract the format F1 and F2 and 3. So where the hormone effect, what's the hormone space? So resonant frequency change depending on the shape of the vocal tract. The vocal feature for the vocal discrimination. And the non-human primates and the first iterators as a first of the piece. So this indicates the hormone distribution of Japanese average females. This is R, E, N, A, O. What is this one? Is it garbage? No, just a robot utterance. Therefore, the robot sound is also quite different from the humans. But somehow, we like to make the robot to get some powers. So also, we pretend that there are simple small brains, so auditory layer and the action layer. So the strategy is, so this is some the robots. The blue box indicates the robots. So at the beginning, so the robots randomly cooing like this one. And here is the caregiver. So if caregiver can interpret one of the sound as one of the his or her own vowels, so he or she became his or her own vowels to the robot. So robot obtained some the hormone features and stores the hormone vector here. And also at the same time, also stores some action vectors. Okay, so how the how change the shape of the vocal tract. So learning is like this one. So as I mentioned, so articulation, long cooing, and practical teaching, and so on. So we connect inspired by the mirror neuron system. So this is an execution, and this is an
observation, perception.
So we connect to this one. Therefore, if the robot listens to some sound of the barbell, then this robot can demand how to vocalize its sound. So this is a smart connection
inspired by the mirror neuron system.
So we have done some experiment, one Japanese guy, my former students, and robots.
Okay.
So the, after the, you know, the interaction, so robot obtains some, you know, the cluster of the Japanese barbells. The attribution vector correspond to the variation of the Kagan's barbells. However, there is an awkwardness in the correspondence. For example, sometimes caregiver randomly like this one. Therefore, some attribution happen.
So we introduce some kind of the subjective criterion of the
on the heavy learning. Let's talk about less deformation changes, and we change the heavy learning to the modified one. Considering the, this kind, these kind of issues, and after that, so the distribution. And you converge to the very small area. Okay.
So that's a result. Can you hear? It's okay?
One more.
Okay. Ooh. I'm sorry, we could not make it all so clearly.
So many people think that this is not a baby voice. Middle age, after karaoke.
So we change it to the air. Okay, the second one is E-A-E-A, but for the Japanese people, yeah, it means no, like this. And also, lip shape is also targeted for the imitations. And then, this lip shape imitation accelerated learning 3 times. And then, so do you feel any pain? So once a month it's broken, therefore all the time I change something. So
of course this is the first step, just one barrel. But now we just try to the 2 barrels and also try to the words and so on. And of course, you know, the consonant is a big challenge. So the group of the Waseda University, they have already set, designed some the vocal robots with the capability of the pronouncing the consonant too. But that's adults. So we would like to seek for the, some kind of the baby robot system and so on. So, and also after this experiment, so many people asked me the, what kind of behavior happen in the caregiver side. So the infant bowel development, many people suggest that some physical quantities of their producible bowels are different. The infant's audition and articulation adapt to mother's tongue. So the expressive dynamic process, including interpersonal interaction and social interaction. And also, one more thing is caregiver's affirmative bias, the delivery, you know, kind of to the baby. So our anticipations bias our perceptions. The caregiver's anticipation for the infants can bias their perception and the imitation as well. Or the caregiver's affirmative interpretation and imitation of infants measure the behavior developed infants' social abilities. So maybe so the caregiver has this kind of bias. So we model that this kind of bias at 2 kinds. The one is the perceptual movement. And actually magnet. We just say the sensory motor magnet. For example, before 6 months, the babies around the world can discriminate the continuous change of the bubbles. For example, like this one. But after 6 months, so due to the effect of the mother's language, mother tongue, so after the 6 months, even though we have shown the continuous change of the R to E, they perceive just a or e. This is a perceptual categorization. So the sensory motor magnet is like this kind of effect. So another one is affirmative bias. That is just we say the auto-negative bias, by which the heard vowel is much closer to the expected vowel because as well as utterance is an indication of the listener's own utterance.
Okay, so we suppose that these two kinds of bias, maybe the caregiver side, affect the different process of the infant vowel acquisitions. The first we try to do some sensory motor magnet. Okay, so we gather the human subject. Actually my students, so much bias anyhow. So we generate some concrete sound, the uniformly distributed around the some vowels. And we just ask the subject to imitate the sound, not the vowel. Please imitate the sound. The result is like this one. So they didn't listen to the sound as it is. They like to listen the sound as their vowels. Okay. So therefore the outcome is the variance is converged. Much. This is some proof of how the human beings has some tendency to the perceptual or sensory motor magnet. Second one is the auto-negative bias. This bias is similar to the placebo effect. Okay, so we have the two groups. One is the control group, is just please imitate the sounds. The experimental group is that of please imitate the sound. Sometimes computer imitates your voice. The actual input is the same, but the reaction of the subject is different. Okay, so this is some result. Okay, so suppose that at time t, so the subject pronounced something. Okay, at t plus one, the computer reacts. At time t plus two, the subject will react again. So we measure some difference of the subject to utterance at time t and t plus 2. If they know the subject expect that, okay, computer should imitate my own voice. At that time, if supposing that, the utterance of the time t and t plus 2 is very similar. Therefore, the difference between the control group and the experimental group is like this one. So statistically, some significant difference. So where the experimental group suppose that, okay, the computer sometimes imitate me, and then therefore I imitate you or something. This is some difference that happened. So we set up some kind of computer simulations, supposing the sensory motor magnet effect, and also the auto-negative bias. So as a computer model, this is indicated the auto-negative bias. The other voice ST is biased to auto-negative anticipation SZT minus 1 and converted SVT is that given by this one. And about the sensory motor mapping module, we use the normalization network to map the other alternative vowel regions onto the listener's one. And by changing the parameters of how much the sensory motor magnetic effect realized. And this is some transfer functions. So the auto-negative bias, the sensory motor mapping, and the module and so on. So this indicates some result of the computation relations. So we suppose that this is the methods about visions, and this is a blue one, and the red one indicates some kind of the infant robots about the visions. So this method will indicate some primitive of the powers. So if we have two biases, so where the blue and the red indicate some interaction between the caregiver and the infants. So as you can see, if the mother has two biases, so the interaction is right this one, and then almost collectively the infant vowel is converged to the right phrase. On the other hand, if okay, so this indicates no auto-negative bias, only the sensory motor magnet effect. Then we'll converge very quickly back to the wrong position. Well, in this case, no magnetic bias. Therefore, only the auto-negative bias. Therefore, the direction is maybe okay, but no convergence. No either bias or the chaotic situation happened. So actually, we need some, you know, the balance between the two biases. So this indicates the sensory motor magnets, and this vertical axis indicates the ordinary bias. And if we choose carefully the two parameters, we obtain a very, you know, good interaction. Otherwise, some wrong correspondence. Okay, the summary. So cognitive robotics is a promising approach to new science of the human cognition with design theory. And the physical environment and social interaction are keys for robots to or infants to develop their cognitive function. The design of robots and their environment as close as humans produce a new research issue to be attacked. So the many people claim to be, why not using the speaker? As I explained, you know, by supposing the physical environment, whoever the less talk or less deformations, the robots obtain the powers. So the physical environment enabled to introduce subject criteria such as less talk and less deformation, easy to vocalize. And now we introduce the expression to realize the time taking with the caregiver for the natural interaction. Now we are designing more realistic infant vocal robot with artificial brain. Okay, the design theory policy is like this one. Okay, I have already passed some time, so I just speed up. Anyway, that's like to study about the interaction between the caregivers and infants. But the infants are very difficult to control. Therefore, we need some more realistic baby robots. So we're to study about some emotional interaction. That means, you know, to realize some kind of some real emotional interaction. So we designed this robot, and the one of our students, actually, in case of the android, the Professor Hiroshi Ishiguro, he is good at the design the android, and he has his own copy. But in that case, we get the poem from a real person. So in that case, maybe the humans should stay 1 hour. I forgot exactly. Then was there a very, very painful face, like this one. So the normal face of the android all the time, like the depressed face or something. So in this case, in case of the baby, we cannot do that, of course. Therefore, one of my students picked up some good picture of the baby, and then make a model and the clay model and get the form and the rest. So next two video clips also you can see in the YouTube. So this is with skin and this is without skin. Okay. So it has more than 20 degrees of freedom, and it has some artificial skin. Just we say human skin there or something. So in the video you cannot perceive that you're touching, but if you touch, it's so realistic. And in this case, the eye is mimic, no TV camera, because if we use a TV camera, it's not so realistic. So anyhow, this only shows us the head, but now we have the torso, and then like some interaction with this kind of movement. Anyhow, acknowledgement is, these are the group leaders of the Professor Hiroshi Ishiguro, Koko Soda, Yasuko Miyoshi, Toshiyomi, and also the Professor of the Project, Dr. Yuichi Yoshikawa, and Dr. Katsumura, and these three candidates. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We have 12 minutes for this session. Please raise your hand and say your name and affiliation.
No questions? Everything clear? Yes, the reception is closing, therefore the people have to be there. Yeah, I'm staying here, so you can ask me personally or any questions.
So that is okay. So I have some.
Okay. Have you modeled the caregiver side? Or what role?
If I understand your questions, did we model the caregiver side, right?
Yes.
So in case of the sensory motor magnet and auto-mirroring bias, that the two bias is one of the assumptions of the two models, the behavior of the caregiver.
And we just in a very simple psychological experiment indicated that maybe human may have such kind of tendency to have the sensory motor magnet and also the automaton bias. That's the, some simulation result of their interaction. So in that case, we support that we model the caregiver's behavior of the autorons, interact with the infants. Did I answer to the question?
My question is, model caregiver side with robots.
Oh, robots. Yeah, that's a good point. Okay, yeah, right, right. So, yes, you are right. So, young infants and robot caregiver.
Yeah.
I suppose maybe the parents still, right? So, because you know, we can get some you know, informed consent before the experiment with the caregivers, but we cannot get the, such a kind of you know, informed consent from the infants, from their parents, therefore.
Robot infant with robot caregiver.
Yeah, robot infants and caregivers, we have some.
Robot infant interacting with robot caregivers.
Oh, the both robots.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. The case of the simulation is the both, you know, robots.
Yeah.
But you suppose that the real one, real robot infant and real robot caregiver. Okay, that's a kind of challenge. Okay. Next time.
On the generic implants. What would be a robot monkey? What would be the difference between your robot and a monkey?
Oh, I didn't think that's a good question. Sometimes we suppose that, as you mentioned, we suppose that robot so handicapped. That means that in some sense similar behavior for children. Or some the vocal system, so like the Williams syndrome. Because in the case of the former, still it's very difficult for the robot to generate a speech by his or her own. Just some replay, then, or some already given the model or something template. But our desire is that robot, you know, by him or herself, to generate, to speak or something, that's current. So in that sense, they're very similar to the autistic children. But in case of the Williams syndrome, for example, the AI system prepared as you know, dictionaries, the many lexicons, and some templates, that's a kind of the normal voice recognition system. In that case, speak too much. But the system does not realize, does not know the real meaning of the sentence and so on. So two extremes. Therefore, my desire is that so in that case, in the former case, it is in sense similar to the monkey. The monkey cannot speak, but I'm not so sure what the difference in reality. Because I suppose maybe monkey, some primate researchers, you know, proud of their monkey, right? So I suppose maybe monkey also has some capabilities and many things that are different from the humans. But the robots is still, you know, less performance, you know, the very handicapped, and in some sense of the development disorder. Therefore, even though compared to the market, still, I suppose maybe, you know, robot still is less performed than monkey. Did I answer to the questions?
Yes, you said that you can want robots to learn language, but language is not limitation. Strings of sound. Right? So, in order to develop a language, you have to have a conceptual intentional system. And then you have to have abstract meaning, not as Massimo just mentioned, as in the part before, which are cross language, cross specific language that enables this mapping to come about sensory motor and conceptual intentional, and in most cases, you will have to deal with abstract entities, so entities that you will not perceive. So how are you going to treat DP anaphora? How are you going to treat ellipses? How are you going to treat concept thoughts? How are you going to
Yeah, of course you are right. So the title of my talk is Towards Long, 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 Long Distance. Therefore, in my project, as I, this one, the red part is only the part of the whole project. The whole project is the joint attention stuff or some, what to say, there are many, many research issues. And in my mind, we like to integrate everything, but still it's very difficult. So as you mentioned, the attention, or the vision, the auditory, the touching, all kinds of the sensors, and you know, the cross-modal mapping, and also the motor development. These kind of issues should be together to think about it. Therefore, of course, we know, we realize that, you know, some kind of the difficulty we have. But in future, back to, of course, you know, one thing I, we are doing is that all the time we seek for positive human error. That's similar to the space science. Okay. Space science, to what, you know, to what extent we do, maybe next week and so on. Even though we try to imitate the human beings, but still there are some differences may happen. Therefore, probably we may be able to realize that similar but still differences happen. Therefore, we suppose that this difference is an essential part for the language of the human. That's my thinking. Therefore, all the time, change attracting or the challenging to the human's capability all the time make for us to attack the new researches all the time. Therefore, the language is all the time, you know, the long, long, long range the goal. But not only the language, but also the cognitive functions together should be developed together. And then, maybe as a result, we'd like to make a real robot that can speak by himself, by herself. Of course, you know, I realized the real program, but today I just showed the only the link of the plan. I'd like to discuss at the reception with Rain.
Do you have any other question of mine?
I have one.
Oh, sure.
So, of course, we can learn from the language acquisition. We can learn the original resolution language from the language study of language acquisition. But I think that people don't catch the connection of your research, constructive growth research about the language acquisition and to the origin and the evolution of language. So how do you think what we can learn from your robotic research about the origin and evolution of language?
Actually, I don't think so.
you think we can learn?
Yeah, we can share. At least we can share some very, very fundamental research issues. And then probably the approach may be different.
Yeah.
So our approach is a purely bottom-up approach. And sometimes, you know, as he asked, you know, what the difference between the monkey and the robot? That's a very right question.
Yeah.
Because, you know, not simply the motor development or the physical embodiment, it not guarantees the language acquisition. So we need more. Therefore, in this, in my talk today, we just focus on the physical environment and social interactions. And we suppose that social interaction triggers some kind of the, some hints or something. Therefore, as a person, maybe physical embodiment is a necessary condition. It's very similar to the animal. But social interaction is another one. And then, as a person, maybe in case of the human, it's very unique. Actually, I believe that the story about Kant is Sarambao's book. I'm not sure the original title of the book. Kant's Therapy, Kanji, the opening chimpanzee, peeing chimpanzee, the Kanji. So many, many primate researchers deny. I know. But for us, it's a kind of a hint to design or something. Okay. So we may have some hard discussion, right? It's okay. I'm ready. So,
yeah, concerning the kanji, it is very easy to understand that in a comparative cognitive science, we have the same ancestor,
but on the different branch now. So we can compare human ability and Sanji or chimpanzee's ability, and where is the common part and what is the different part. And common part will be acquired before the planting. But about the development, we cannot compare like a chimpanzee and human baby and robot baby and human baby. That is not on the same lineage.
Mm-hmm. But some researchers mentioned there some the similar pathway of the autistic children and chimpanzee. For example, the imitation, the attachment is necessary to teach the imitation of something or other things. Therefore, very, very superficially, I believe that there are some common problems.
So, in that line of reasoning, I thought you found that two biases are necessary, auto-mirroring and magnet biases, to do imitation. I think it's a great finding, because we can take auto-mirroring as a cue to integrate this area of study and the language acquisition study, and we can also study what animals does auto-mirroring and so on, and what is the mechanism of auto-mirroring. This will be interesting.
Yes. Actually, we suppose that the auto-mirroring virus is not limited to this one, but we can adapt to generalize this kind of the concept to the development itself.
You know, it's quite an engineering feat for which you must be really complimented, but it has anything to do with what we know about how children, you know, acquire even the sounds of language. You know, a few hours after birth, we know that they can make a difference between the mother's tongue and another language. They already can do that. We know that they are sensitive to all the phonological contrast in all the languages of the world. And then they lose it, you know, when they get to the 11th month. We know that they have categorical perception, so you have a continuum of variation of the first 4 months, you know, and it makes a sharp, you know, transition. So all the things we know about how, you know, children do this, it seems to me completely different from what we're seeing here.
As you mentioned, this is a kind of the engineer solution. So we end up some kind of some artificial cues and so on. But actually, we like to realize some U shape, as you mentioned. At the beginning, good performance, and then limited performance, and then again like this one. So actually, in our group, we have shown, for example, in case of the joint attention. So we suppose that immature vision first. And then, so at the beginning, so the infant is very coarse, very rough image of the other pole, and then gradually changing. And this bias enables the infant get the more, the accelerated from joint attention. Now that kind of the story is a very similar situation of the infants. We believe that also in this case, the infants is starting from the very, very immature stage and then gradually happen. Actually, today, I skip some details about the development process of the motor skills. So at the beginning, the motor skills and also the perception of the listening skills are also very, very immature. And this makes, you know, good things for the infant to develop, because, you know, at the beginning, capture the whole things, everything together, and then gradually separate it. If the infant has, from the beginning, if the infant has a very fine acuity of the vision and fine acuity of the perception, it's very difficult to find some right correspondence. So today I have not shown this result, but if you have time, I'd like to show that this kind of situation. Of course, as you mentioned, it's very, very different from the children, the other children happen, but we'd like to find some kind of the common essential part between the human development and the robot development.
Okay, it's time to drink. Thank you very much for this.
Thank you.